Relations between the U.S. and Pakistan have hit a new low after a top American military chief accused Pakistan's intelligence service of supporting a group behind last week's attack on the American embassy in Kabul. Islamabad has strongly denied the claims. Assistant editor of antiwar.com, John Glazer, says the U.S. wants to be recognized as the world's policeman, but turns a blind eye to the violence it causes itself.
Well, I mean, it's for a long time it's been recognized by sources in government and outside that the Pakistani government, and specifically the ISI, has some ties to various militant groups in Pakistan. The problem is that the U.S. has dealt with it for about a decade until now. And the reason is that they're getting all riled about it now is because they're losing in Afghanistan. The U.S. government is being a little too aggressive. I mean, they're upset with Pakistan for what they call a proxy war through the Haqqani network into Afghanistan. But the U.S. is running their own brutal war in Afghanistan. The Afghan National Police have been, which is the group that is funded and trained by the United States government, they have been terrorizing local communities and villages throughout Afghanistan for years. Human Rights Watch just came out with a report condemning them for killings, illegal detentions, rape, murder, abductions, so on and so forth. And so that's a proxy war. What's strange is that when the Pakistanis do it, the U.S. calls it terrorism. And when the U.S. does it, it's called counterterrorism. So the relationship is inherently contradictory, and they're both playing the same sort of bad game. The only question is how many more civilians have to die for these two to sort of level out their power play.
One of the stumbling blocks in U.S.-Pakistan relations is that American drone attacks on al-Qaeda operatives on Pakistani territory continually resulted in civilian deaths. However, the U.S. military considers them so effective that it is building a number of new drone bases in Horn of Africa and the Arabian Peninsula. But as RT's Ganesh Chikan reports, this policy has caught America in a vicious circle.
The U.S. is aggressively expanding its drone war by setting up more and more bases for those unmanned aerial vehicles, or the UAVs. They're armed with laser-guided bombs and air-to-ground missiles. A network of those drone bases is unfolding in East Africa. Ethiopia is hosting a fleet of hunter killers, as they call them in the military. A similar installation has opened in the Seychelles. A new base is under construction somewhere in the Arabian Peninsula to enable more flights over Yemen. And all this, as U.S. officials say, is being done to target al-Qaeda affiliates in the region. Drones have become the main weapon of America's undeclared wars. It's a new kind of warfare, one that the U.S. is waging without sacrificing the lives of their soldiers in a number of countries like Pakistan, Yemen, and Libya, for that matter. In Pakistan, for example, U.S. drone strikes have killed thousands of civilians and have netted only a handful of actual terrorists. Many of the victims' loved ones seek revenge, often by joining radical groups. So it's like a vicious circle when the U.S. seems to be fighting terror and provoking terror at the same time. And the question whether or not the policies make America safer is very arguable. But on top of the human cost and the boomerang effect of those often indiscriminate strikes, there's also the price tag of such rapid drone expansion. We're talking about billions of dollars of U.S. taxpayers' money at a time when the country is on the verge of another recession, when 14 million people are jobless, and one in six Americans lives on food stamps. And many here do find it outrageous that with a gigantic debt problem, sluggish economy, and with three wars at hand, American officials still lavish money on military projects, which some experts say may well backfire at their own security.